On Late Tackle tonight, is your football costing too much? Are the money men putting the game beyond the reach of the average fan?
We ask, are the big clubs losing touch with their fans, or do the folk at the turnstiles still matter?
Also tonight, top sports personalities as you've never seen them before. Alex Ferguson shows why he's king of the Reds. From the catwalk to the front row, we meet Leicester's ABC club. And Jim Rosenthal on why he prefers the Manor Ground to Monte Carlo.
Finish!
We haven't started yet. With us on Late Tackle is our regular deadly duo, Ron Atkinson, just back from checking his bank account in Monaco, and Barry Fry, who's still counting the pennies at Peterborough.
And I'll be inviting the studio audience to make their point. Perhaps they'll be talking through their pockets.
But first, we examine an issue that affects every football fan. Has the game gone money mad at the expense of its core support? Clive Tildesley investigates.
Street level support is drifting away. In general, a lot of fans are being priced out of the game.
So is there a different kind of customer inside the ground now?
Yeah, no doubt about it. Yeah, and I think that's what the clubs want as well.
Who are those people then?
The ones who've got more money to spend.
The opportunities to spend money in and around football grounds are limitless. If you want a flutter, if you want a party, if you want anything at all endorsed by your favourite football club, they can oblige.
The commercial side of a football club, you're right in saying, is fundamental to any football team. Long has gone the days where a football club could rely on gate receipts alone. If you look at our income at the moment for this current campaign, we're projecting that our income totally for the football club will be just under £30 million, and half of that roughly will come from commercial activities and broadcasting.
It does mean, in pure factual terms, that the guy who will stand at the turnstiles for 10 minutes to queue to come in isn't quite as important as he was.
I wouldn't say he's not as important. We need the fans and we need their atmosphere and we need the replica sales for the shirts that they bring and everything else. But there is a growing market for the corporate side and there is a clear growing demand for people who want to eat at matches and want to be here and want to enjoy the excitement of it all.
Once upon a time, eating at the match was all about a sausage roll and a wagon wheel. Now it's about wining and dining, if you can afford it. Well-heeled, corporate fans are invited to join private members' clubs offering fantasy football facilities.
Two very good seats, the facility of a wonderful restaurant and a car park. And, of course, you meet the right sort of people, really.
And per match, roughly, how much does that cost you for that privilege?
Well, it's £100 for two tickets, which is quite a lot of money, and which is well spent, of course, if we have success on the park.
Our activity is about bringing our customers and our ability to get our customers to the game and to actually host our customers within an environment like this. And it's very professional. It's also very cost effective, as I say, as part of our PR package.
Some football clubs will always have a better record than others on the park. All football clubs now recognise the commercial opportunities of having a loyal and captive audience. They're all enjoying success off the park.
If I can take you back into the late 60s, there wasn't a souvenir shop as such, nothing like the mega stores that you see today. We just had a small shop that sold a handful of scarves, hats, gloves, and maybe a few shirts. Now you're talking about into the hundreds and thousands of shirts, scarves, hats. You name it, as far as merchandise is concerned now, we sell it.
Yes, what about a garter and suspender set? We do those and they're £6. Okay.
You're probably talking about in excess of £4 million turnover just from this department alone.
I mean?
The house full signs are going up at most Premiership grounds these days. The demand is certainly there. So the suppliers, the clubs, are charging the market price. And for the away fan in particular, that's not cheap.
We're not viable to a club. A club to survive, and we know this, does not actually sort of appreciate the fan who comes on a day-to-day basis. You'll not get players. Players won't talk to us now. You'll not get managers who sort of understand our needs or our wants, because really, all they're interested in is the mighty dollar.
If you take your family, it costs £50 for two. Cost £75 to take four people. You struggle to take your kids. We haven't brought the kids today because it's just too expensive.
I think the day will come in the end when normal fans cannot afford to come to football anymore, and then teams will not perform without those players. But it's really whether the clubs can build that sort of corporate side of it where they don't need the fans anymore. And that may well happen.
What do you think when you glance at behind those glass boxes and see somebody raising a glass of wine and maybe finishing off their dessert, you know, just before the game? What do you think about those people?
Well, personally, good luck to them. If they're having fun, I don't care. At the end of the day, they're paying, and in a way, they're subsidising the rest of us.
Well said, that man. Let's throw this to Freddie Fletcher, Chief Executive of Newcastle United, first of all. Freddie, how important are the fans at the turnstiles in terms of revenue to a club like yours? Where do they come in the league table?
Well, our turnover last year was about £42 million. And about 35% of that was the income through the gate and 65% from other activities. But let me qualify
so
that.
So they're probably, what, third in the list?
No, let's qualify it, though. You've got to look at it deeper than that. For example, our retail shop turned over £9 million last year. Now, it's those very fans that are paying in the turnstile who use the retail shop. Our lottery, which made a lot of money, it's those very fans that use the lottery. Our main sponsor is Scottish and Newcastle Brewery. And the reason they pay us a lot of money is because our fans go into the pubs and drink their products. So I think it's far too simplistic to say the turnstile prices are purely the fans and the rest are some mystery person. I think you trace the most of it to the fans.
If your fans are that important to you for all the reasons you've said, isn't there a case for charging them less?
Well, I mean, one of the things I always say, we do talk-ins around the working men's clubs with our sponsor. And the first year I was at Newcastle, 91-92, the first signing we made was Brian Kilcline. Yeah. Now, super signing, he stopped us getting relegated to the old third division. And I say to the fans, if that is the type of player you want to come and watch, then I can reduce the prices. If you want Alan Shearer, if you want us to break the world record transfer and have Alan Shearer in the park, then we've got to generate the money to have Alan Shearer. And the message comes over to the fans, no, we want to compete at the very highest echelons of football. We want to be in Europe. We want it to be playing Barcelona. We want to be playing Dynamo Kiev. And we want players who have got the ability to take us there. And you've got to pay them.
OK, David Gold, chairman of Birmingham City. Do you think there's a case for lowering prices? I mean, are the fans being taken for a bit of a ride?
No, I don't think there is a case for lowering the prices. I think the prices are driven by the economies that I feel...
What about the economy of a guy out of work?
Well, that applies to whatever he might be doing. If he goes to the pictures, he can't go to the pictures if he's out of work. We're talking about the working class man. You can't have a structure that is based upon people that are out of work. You know, that we do have facilities where we try and bring in kids for a quid. Is something that Birmingham City have tried. We've had times when we've brought in and reduced prices to £5 for special B-rated matches. So we're doing everything we can, but it is an economy. As Freddie is saying, by the way, Birmingham City doesn't generate £42 million. We're a first division club. We don't have the luxury of £6-10 million worth of TV revenue, and we have to, and our fans are part of the club. They are as determined as we are to move up into a higher division. They want success. They want to see top quality players. You're not going to do that if you have an unrealistic income coming through the turnstiles.
Okay, if you go up to a higher division, you're going to charge them more. That's the trouble.
Well,
do you know the average fan non-season ticket holder, Barry, pays £700 a year to watch his team. Your fans wouldn't pay that much, would they, at Peterborough?
No, I mean, we're talking about catering for different levels, isn't it? Premiership, Birmingham's trying to get in the Premiership. At Peterborough, we're just trying to put bums on seats. And to do that, we've got to reduce the prices, which what we've done. We're the only club in the country that reduced our prices at the start of the season. And even if you buy a ticket in advance, it's reduced by a further pound. I mean, kids and old-age pensioners at Peterborough can come in for £3, sit anywhere. Sit in a director's box, sit in a dugout with me, sit anywhere. We're trying to attract families. Whereas, to be fair, Premiership clubs and David at Birmingham, with ambitions to get in the Premiership, I mean, the average family person can't afford to go to them games twice a week, in my opinion.
No, I mean, they've got the money, you haven't got the money, no. You need to raise it. Mark Bosnich, as a player, what's your view of this? I mean, do you look at the fans in Villa Park and think, thanks to you guys, I'm a millionaire?
Well, I think it's just a simple case of supply and demand. It's like anything in life. I mean, what price do you put on entertainment? We are now in the entertainment business. We've got a product that's fantastic, that's watched all around the world. And you're going to get, you know, when you make something consumer-friendly, a lot of people are going to be attracted. And I think, you know, in every walk of life, if you want to go sit at the best seats of the opera, you pay the best prices. If you want to go, you know, see the opera, but you can't afford the best prices, you sit, you know, in the back seats. It's simple.
If I want to take my son to see 1.5 hours entertainment at the cinema, it might cost me a fiver, and I'm guaranteed a good film. I don't get a nil-nil draw.
Yeah, but could you tell me every character of the cinema, or their real names? You couldn't, but I bet you could tell me the Premier
League
players.
Big names.
It's entertainment. You think? I mean, yeah. We're talking about the cinema. You maybe go to see one person at best, and when you're talking about now Premier League soccer, we're talking about worldwide.
I mean,
everywhere you go. I mean, we went to Saudi Arabia with the Australian team in December. It's being shown live there, and there's people there who, you know, due to whatever, live quite a sheltered life.
Yeah.
Yet they know every Premier League, the majority of the Premier League players.
Well, they see it on telly as well, don't they?
Well, that is my point.
Yeah. You know, Ron, let's just come to you because your club, Sheffield Wednesday, is one of the three cheapest clubs in the top flight to go and see. The others are Wimbledon and Everton. I mean, do you have strong views about what the fan has to pay?
I think what should be straight away cleared up is the clubs don't care about the fans, because there'll never be a day in football when it's just simply and purely corporate hospitality, when people are sitting in glass boxes watching matches, because the game won't mean anything. It's like having it just simply and purely televised.
Yeah.
So I think you should get that people should get that out of their mind straight away. And I think Barry said, people have choice now, you know. People have choice. If they can afford it, and I'm sure anybody that could afford it would want the top corporate hospitality that's available at clubs, fine. But I think the clubs, and I tell you what, Freddie's club, they're queuing up. They could get another 20,000 to watch Newcastle play. The working man.
Yeah, they need a new stadium.
And the other thing, we talk about the price of football. You mentioned, I think, £700 to watch a football team for a year, something like that. Now, there's a lot of working men now, in the last decade or so, play golf. Now, you tell me how much it costs to play golf, take a membership up. It costs an awful lot more than that, you know.
OK, but it's when you take your family, it gets a bit dearer. Let's throw it to the audience.
Take your family golfing.
Well, this is the FA Premier League National Fan Survey commissioned by the Premier League. The author from the University of Leicester is John Williams. John, what is the conclusion you've come to about the cost for the average fan?
Well, it's not cheap. £17 a ticket, average price. League matches in some places, £25. Major London waiting, but not across the board at London, interestingly. Arsenal is much cheaper than Tottenham, particularly as an away fan, so you can't argue there's a simple London waiting.
What about the Midlands?
Again, some variation there, but the Midlands are around the middle rather than very high or very low. But I think what is disturbing is that about two-thirds of all supporters, and these are people who are actually going to matches now, say that they don't think it's easy for ordinary people to come down and support their club. And I think that's where the tension lies. I think fans felt they had a kind of a contract with the game which said, look, we need the corporate sponsorship, we need the kinds of people that we saw on your film to come in, we need the money from merchandising because that's what will keep prices down. And I think what's happening instead is that clubs, you know, quite understandably, because they're in the marketplace, are saying, we'll charge whatever we think we can get. But that does mean that certain kinds of people, the unemployed, the poor, the lowly paid, the people who are in and out of work, can't go.
OK, you can hear all that. Good arguments up there. An argument from John Williams from his research. Who agrees with that? Anybody? What do you think?
Yeah, I think he's quite right. I mean, the cost of football now is absolutely amazing. And the bit that amazes me with the panel is they've been very analytical and sort of very businesslike in their approach. The whole thing about football, for everybody sitting in this audience, is that football's about passion. I mean, I'm a 42-year-old man, and when I go to a football match, you know, I'm like a little kid. I'm there, and I get the thrill of it all. But realistically, the cost is just getting so much.
Don't you want to see the best players? You want your team, I think it's Leicester, to be successful.
Yeah, I mean, I want Leicester City to win the
Premier
League.
You want the best players, don't you?
I want the best players.
You've got to pay for it.
But again, there's a partnership. I mean, 80% of the income is derived through sort of sponsorship and corporateness. So really, to some extent, that should actually subsidise the fans. Take away the fan from the football match and you might as well play to an empty stadium. It'll be meaningless. The television coverage
will
be
there. Well, hang on, they are going to go. They'll sell out crowds. How much do you pay to go and see Leicester per match?
I actually do have a season ticket and I pay probably £370 a year to go and watch Leicester.
But Matt, you see, that's pretty good value, you know. If you go and see a pop concert, it could cost you £22. Who else has got a view on this? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Don't the people on the panel think that they're taking far too much out of the game? They're all overpaid. I mean, I don't know about the guys on the end there who are executives. I mean, all of a sudden, we didn't have chief executives earning £200,000 a year before. We had directors who did the job for nothing.
Hang on a bit. He makes millions of pounds.
But I'm not going to defend him. I'm going to ask Freddie to answer that.
Yeah, can I just say this? I was brought to Newcastle from Glasgow Rangers in January 92, and the directors who did the job weren't paid. And the reason I was bought is because the company was going to the third division and going into liquidation. Yeah. We're now in the Premier League, and in this year we're in the Champions League. So I would argue that what I get paid as chief exec has been good value for money. Yeah. I also think that you know, you can argue this from any way. If you read that same survey that we're talking about on the merchandise, there were only 5% of the fans who said they thought that the merchandising policies were immoral. So 95% didn't. Now, it's very easy for Panorama or David Meller, who I know personally like very much, to make himself rich and famous.
All right, let's just break you off there, Freddie, because we could run away with the whole show
here.
Let's
talk about the fact.
Let's just ask David Gold on your left there. How much have you put into Birmingham City?
First of all, myself, the Gold Brothers and David Sullivan, between us, we've put in £8 million into Birmingham City. Apart from our managing director, Karen Brady, none of the directors, that's including my brother, David Sullivan, and the rest of the directors, nobody receives any income whatsoever.
Well, perhaps you're an exception. I mean, Newcastle United have gone public, right?
Yes.
It's all now about making fortunes for shareholders, isn't it? All the money's
rubbish
at the top.
That's rubbish. What it's a bit about, you see, I believe that tribalism drives football, and it's the fan that drives the tribalism, and that if any club gets that wrong, they'll not be successful. 100%.
And well, you know, your fans have come and watched Newcastle, whatever you were doing,
you
wherever you were.
The average attendance when I came was 13,000. That was average attendance. So they wouldn't come.
Let me just come in and ask one more person from the audience for a view on this.
Coming back to what he's just said, that you can get another 20,000 at Newcastle. You've done a survey for how many season ticket holders was owned by women, which was, I think, very low, correct? Now, I take my wife, and up till last year, my daughter, and it works out very dear. Now, Barry Fry's just said about getting the families interested. We take an away coach, we've got two young lads of 18 and 19, and everything else is our age. Now, I'm going to ask you, if you keep on that theory, where's your next generation of football fans coming? Because I can't afford to take them, and you're creaming it.
All right, Freddie, you're creaming it.
Well, we're not creaming it. We've got a very low percentage of women's season tickets, because we're completely sold out and the stadium's too small. The influx of increase in women is over the last few years. Well, we've had a sellout stadium since 94, so they can't get in. We have about 20,000 in the waiting list, and that's why we're doing the new stadium, where hopefully construction work will start in May. And then the number of women supporters and children supporters will increase because of the capacity to let them in.
Which I think we're going to have to stop it there, fellas. We could go on all night, but we haven't got time. Gary?
Yeah, interesting stuff. It could have gone on all night. Meanwhile, this weekend sees the start of the new Formula One season, and our star over the moon tonight is a man currently in Melbourne to present ITV's coverage of the first Grand Prix of the year. But before he flew down under, he had time to give his local team one final cheer.
Hello from Albert Park, Melbourne. Good afternoon from Monte Carlo. Welcome to Interlagos.
I'll tell you what, forget Silverstone, forget the Australian Grand Prix, the man on ground on a Saturday afternoon, this is the place to be.
Ooh, click on. Yes, David! Yay! Stevie, David! And David, right in!
Oxford United has been part of my life from the moment I was knee-high, really. I was born in this city. My parents still live here. I went to school in Oxford. I worked on the local paper in Oxford, and although I've moved away since, I've always followed Oxford United. I always think that football teams find you, really. And someone said to me, you bleed yellow, don't you? And that's the way I feel sometimes. And believe me, supporting Oxford United, you get a few days where you do hemorrhage pretty badly.
Come on, Joey! Oh, brilliant, Joey. Brilliant, Joey. He's got his hair, he's here. Drop it into him, drop it in. Finish!
There's one character who I seem to remember from back in those non-league days. He was a guy called Ron Atkinson, and my first memories of Ron, when I used to stand behind the goal, he used to have these shorts that he pulled right up and rolled down over his... He didn't have a big belly at those in those days, but he rolled them down, and he used to grease his legs, Ron, and he would come out, no matter what the weather was or what the temperature was, with the shorts rolled up and the legs greased, and you could smell the liniment. And we used to call Ron Atkinson the Tank, and he was the Oxford United leader, and he led Oxford United from the Southern League right up to, well, what would now be the First Division, the old Second Division, played hundreds of games for us. Ron Atkinson was his name. I always thought he would have some sort of future in the game after he left Oxford. I'm not quite sure what he's doing with himself now, though. Jim Smith era was another terrific period for the club. He took us up twice in successive years, right up to the First Division. And ironically, when he left, his team got to the Milk Cup final at Wembley, which was probably Oxford United's greatest single day. There's a place in the sun that belongs to everyone. Presenting the game for ITV, and it was Oxford against QPR, and I thought, well, I can either do the normal presentation job or I can show everybody that I'm a real fan. And when we won 3-0 at the end of it, I said, I'm sorry, this is my team, it's our day, there aren't going to be that many days when I'm going to be presenting the programme at Wembley and Oxford United are going to win the cup. And I picked up this Oxford United hat and put it on at the end.
And if it's good enough for the skipper, Malcolm Shotton, it'll do for me.
It was a great moment for me. It didn't do my career a lot of good, I'd have to say, but it was a great personal moment for me.
I'm not a stretcher bearer. We got the fattest, slowest stretcher bearers in the Nationwide League. Here she comes. He won't get on the stretcher, he'll get up and... They always see the stretcher and walk away. Don't you want to get on anything carried by them? Go on, the big man! Yay! Yay! Kevin Francis!
Another day of sporting extravaganza at the Manor. 3-0. Yes!
What I'm wondering, Barry, is what did become of Ron Atkinson?
Well, after he left Oxford, he went to a club as player-manager, and the Tank continued his famous career by getting Kettering Town promotion 2 years on the trot, And then he went on to be Cambridge United, West Bromwich Albion, Manchester United.
He didn't finish up on television, did he?
I don't know. I don't know about that one.
What's this about greasing your legs?
What I do know is Jim still owes me plenty. He used to come around scrounging tickets and all sorts. He's the biggest scrounger you've ever met as a kid.
You mean he didn't pay for his tickets?
Are you sure?
I better rescue Ron. I thought for a moment he was almost embarrassed there. Well, after the break, Alex Ferguson on his favourite Reds and three men in a scrum, Leicester's ABC club. But first, it's over to Angus with the big cats.
Which golfer won the 1997 US Masters in his first full season as a professional? This really is quite an easy question for you, but the answer after the break. I get knocked down. We asked you just before the break which golfer in his first full season as a pro won the 1997 US Masters. And the answer, of course, wasn't Tiger Watch, but Tiger Woods.
Last night, over 11 million ITV viewers watched Manchester United's Champions League quarter-final in Monaco. It was an important night at the office for the United manager Alex Ferguson as he employed all his professional nous trying to guide his team towards the trophy he wants most of all. But a couple of weeks ago, late tackle caught up with Alex Ferguson in a different part of France as he indulged a very different passion.
The fertile land of the Bordeaux region in southern France is reckoned to be the best wine country in the world. The production of vintage red is both art and science, and that's as true here in France as it is at the top of the FA Carling Premiership in England. The Manchester United manager Alex Ferguson has a nose for fine wine as well as fine football, and a recent visit to one of the great chateaux alongside the Staffordshire wine expert Stephen Williams uncorked a man with a passion for excellence.
What we've got here is a spread of vintages that cover 5 years. From 1986 through till 1994. So anyway, why don't we taste something? And this is what it's all about, isn't it, really? So first of all, we'll have a look at the 1986 vintage.
And nice fruits in there, isn't it?
I don't know what was going on in your world in 1986.
Well, I think I joined a big club. Well, in 86, of course, I wasn't so devoted to wine, but it was a great year for me because probably the biggest year of my life, joined Manchester United.
Right.
What can I say? That is Grand Cru.
Yeah, that's right. So let's try the 1991. Okay. Now, 1991's interesting because this was a very, very difficult vintage. We very rarely see 1991 on the market. I mean, there's just none of it around. But what there is actually quite good.
And maybe the greatest vintage of all time, for me anyway. 1991, won the Cup Winners' Cup against Barcelona and Rotterdam. So I'm not complaining about that year.
Maybe not now. Yes, there is! A fantastic goal by Hughes!
Times are terrific because then open the best. I remember at the Magnum of Chateau Watteau, 1982.
Oh, fabulous.
And opened it at Christmas, not last Christmas, the Christmas before that. And Mark, my oldest son, he lived in Paris, so yeah. he's quite good in the wines. He says, Dad, this is my Christmas present. When he saw the wine, I said, no, you're getting a toothbrush. It's not anything like that. You're just getting an ordinary present. This is for everyone. Oh, it's fantastic. There was a sort of expectation and anticipation right. Having a really nice glass of wine for a Christmas lunch that day.
Oh, that's super.
Yeah, it was good, that. It was a good one, that.
Yeah.
In 92, we won the League Cup.
Right.
Notts Forest. 1-0, Brian McClair. It's always a good year when you win something like that.
That's right.
A goal for Manchester United. There we are. The first time.
1993, Alex. The sun started shining again. Again, it was a good, good summer. But we found that there was just a little dilution again during through showers during the harvest. Yeah. So the wine was considerably better. But the wine's now delicious to enjoy today.
That's very nice. And this, to me, was the key that opened the door for Manchester United. And I always said when I came to the club, there's only one thing that matters, winning the Premier Division, winning that title. It unlocked everything. Because we hadn't done it for 26 years, and this was the first year we did it, 1993. So it was a fantastic year. '94 was, they reckon, is the best year for Manchester United. Probably, maybe not ever, but one of the greatest years, because it was the first time Manchester United ever did the double.
Right.
And it was a really tremendous team. It was a team which you could say was full of all characters from many ways of line. The strength, the proper vintage, you say, the experience of the team, the speed. It was a really, really good team.
Ince is there again and finds Hughes. It's a good-looking ball. Keane's cross, clean across the face of goal, and it's a goal! Brian McClair has scored for Manchester United with only 4 minutes gone.
We all enjoy drinking this stuff, or most of us do, but, I mean, do you find that the interest in it is a good relaxation for you? Thank you.
We're talking about going over on the plane with the managers this morning. Dave Pleat saying, I really admire you because you take other interests. And I've been doing that the last 2 or 3 years because I think that after 23 years of management, Gary, I'll have to find, and we should find, other interests. Mm. And for 23 years, I've been obsessed with the management side of it, football management, players, what they're doing, and you're almost like a father to them. And you forget your own life. And I've had to learn in the last 2 or 3 years how to withdraw out of it, to handle the pressure, to escape from the pressure of it. And I find that certain things like this, like wine, even started trying to play the piano, learning that. I bought 2 racehorses. I mean, people say, well, where do you get the time for all that? But it's a matter of saying, right, how to handle that, how to escape from pressure and find other interests.
Alex, I've enjoyed your company, I've enjoyed your friendship, I've enjoyed those great European nights and watching all the trophies you won for Manchester United, but I never thought I'd say this. Down with the Reds.
I can't believe it. It's come from a brummie.
Well, our guide is Stephen Williams from the Antique Wine Company. How good is Alex's knowledge?
Well, he's very knowledgeable, Gary. He certainly knows which are the best chateaus. And the other thing that Alex really understands is that just like football, every year presents a completely new set of challenges. And with the weather, every vintage is different.
Thank you. Tony.
After the second glass, all wine tastes all right, doesn't it? Time now for Angus and a regular feature we originally called Beat the Bookie. But after 2 weeks and no winners, we might be renaming it Bookie's Benefit. Angus, what have you got to say for yourself?
Well, Tony, I certainly fancied Middlesbrough last week, and it was bitterly disappointing to see them get hammered not just once, but twice. Well, the Grand Prix season starts the weekend, and I fancy Mika Hakkinen. He's 4-1 to win the first race. And in the football, Celtic to win in the Scottish Cup, Coventry to win in the English Cup, and for the double, you can get 2-1. Now, that looks value to me.
Well, thank you, Angus. Hopefully we can recoup some of our losses from the past 2 weeks. We need to. A change of sport now, from round ball to oval to rugby union, a complicated sport, some might think. But to a trio from Leicester, well, it's as easy as ABC.
Once upon a time, there was a scaffolder.
Darren Garforth, 5'11", 18 and a little bit.
A restorer of antique furniture.
Richard Cockerill Hooker, 5'10", 16 stone.
And a cappuccino-addicted insurance broker.
Taking the cream off, of course.
Graham Rowntree, loose-head prop, 6 foot, about 17 stone.
They craved a little excitement and formed the most formidable front line since Genghis Khan conquered half the world.
Plus 2 makes 4, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9.
They call themselves the ABC Club, the letters worn by the Leicester front row. ABC.
Become a member of the ABC Club. Is it just open to you three?
Unfortunately, yeah, it's a closed shop now. We're the Leicester front row, and nobody else is going to take our places. So unlucky, isn't it?
What exactly is a cauliflower ear in medical terms?
Well, that's a cauliflower ear.
We'll
get a close up. One I prepared earlier. The cartilage in your ear, when you have a series of scrums or tackling, even sorry to bore you, the blood vessels swell up. Well, that's what gives it a cauliflower ear. If you just leave it, it turns out like that. But you can have it lanced or drained, but mine just kept going, so I just left it.
Darren Garforth may supply a seaforce of over 18 stone, but he can sell a dummy like Barry John. He didn't sidestep the ref, though. Darren started out as a soccer striker.
I was going to play a game of football with my kit bag over my shoulder and... got to the game. These pair have fallen asleep, we've heard it so many times. I got to the game and they'd called it off and I was walking home and a minibus of lads went past the new, going to play rugby and I jumped in and that's how I started.
Richard Cockerill found fame by eyeballing New Zealand hooker Storming Norman Hewitt during the All Black sacred and traditional war dance, the Haka.
They were obviously laying down the challenge of the Haka and I was just saying, come on son, over here if you think you're hard enough, you know, and fortunately we were up to it.
Dare we mention this, that you've never had your nose broken and you've got all your own teeth?
Yeah, I haven't broken my nose, all my teeth are there, no cauliflower ears, you see. That's what two good props does for you, they look after me pretty well.
Yeah, we've got the broken noses and the cauliflower ears and the no teeth.
Reporter Dennis Scrope, and from the England and Leicester front row to our front row, the ABC Club. I was just wondering, which of you three is most likely to pull the birds?
Darren was, but now he's married, obviously he's off the scene now, so and we're both engaged, so don't get into that.
So, OK, well, that's fair enough. Now, who's the boss of you three?
Big Mouth.
Me, I'm afraid. I do the talking, then they do the action, so it's the best way to have it, I think.
And these cauliflower ears, you've managed to avoid those?
Yeah, well, I seem to cause all the trouble, and these boys look after me, so they get all the dents, so it's not too bad.
OK, now, why aren't these two guys in the current England team with you?
Well, I don't want to say something too controversial. It's just a bit of bad luck, really. Darren's been in the side and played against France and was left out for the last game, and you know, Graham's been there and got 15 caps. And
just been left out.
And hopefully he'll get back in the side, but it's just, you know, one of those things. It swings and roundabouts for us all.
OK, we must get a little controversial. That's what we want to do in this programme, even for rugby players. So who earns all the dosh here? I mean, Leicester Tigers, professional club now.
Oh, it is professional, but there's not that much money in the game, so we
But who earns the most money?
Out of us three all.
Yeah.
Graham's
got all the money, all the dough.
And all the nice clothes.
Look at him.
Yeah, you are the smoothest dresser of the three.
I think we're all on a similar kind of contract, really. We all signed up for 5 years, and I think we're all getting the same kind of money.
Well, I hope we are.
Do you feel you're equal with football players? I mean, you heard the debate earlier about all the money that's in football.
I think rugby, as we've seen, some clubs have gone in too deep and bought expensive players and now are struggling financially. And I think a lot of clubs have got to be realistic on what they pay their guys. You know, yeah. If they can afford it, pay it them. If you can't, you know, unfortunately, you can't have those sort of players. As we know, it's a business.
Rugby is still really finding its feet professionally. And we're only really into our second season of professional rugby.
OK, well, with ears like that, you deserve every penny you do get. Thank you very much. Well done, lads. The ABC Club!
The great thing about cauliflower ears, hope to keep your glasses on, don't they? And your hat. Coming up after the break, the goals and the controversy from the midweek action in Europe. And the man who makes Barry Fry's half-time team talk sound like a Sunday sermon. But first, it's Angus with another of his animal crackers.
Which Football League club launched its penguin strip earlier this season? Answer, after the break.
Down, but I get up again, you're never gonna
We asked you before the break which club launched its penguin strip at the start of the season. Now, the answer, of course, is Birmingham City.
And what a good job they picked up a point at Norwich last night. Anyway, welcome back. Next, the further adventures of a sad, overweight football fan in search of a life on the way to the World Cup.
Play with it, yeah. Eat it? A French could eat this for breakfast every day. I'm just lazy.
Nicole, papa. Nicole, papa. De Gaulle, as nouveau. Nicole, papa.
Hello? Oh, Lord Mayor of Paris? Yeah, look, your clocks are all an hour out, mate. Everyone's going to miss the game. Can you get it sorted? Yeah, cheers.
And there'll be more from our cultural attaché next week. Back to this week's business and the restart of the European football season. After the first leg of the Champions League quarter-finals, it's still anybody's guess. Spaniards gave themselves... And fresh from Monaco, Ron Atkinson. How do you rate United's chances for the title, I suppose, they want to win more than any of the other seven contestants in the quarter-finals, don't they?
I wouldn't say that they'll all want to win it. I mean, there's some great sides left in the tournament and everyone will want to win it. I think United had a smashing result last night. The result was actually far better than the performance.
Yeah.
They've still got plenty to do in the... it's not all over. It's not a foregone conclusion.
No, they're quite handy away from home, Monaco, aren't they?
Yeah, and you can see why. I mean, they can play on the counter and so forth. But I would think if United put on one of their European performances, what we call the high tempo job, I think they'll just about see them off. But it won't be easy.
I'm just wondering, Barry, with the pressure on Manchester United to win this title that's eluded them for 30 years, in this, the 40th anniversary of Munich and so on, could that count against them as much as for them?
I don't think so. I mean, I think Alex has made it clear right from the start that's his number one priority. And I think getting to Old Trafford in front of 55,000, I think they'll roar him on to a famous victory. I do, personally.
The FA Cup didn't seem to be a priority, did it?
No, the FA Cup and the Coca-Cola went out the window.
Well, let's hope he's left with something, the big one. What do you think about United quickly, Mark?
Well, I mean, European Cup, or the Champions League, as it's now called, is the ultimate in club competition for every player. And I think Manchester United have done so much domestically over the last 7 or 8 years. And the only thing that's perhaps that they still want to prove is they can win the European Cups as Liverpool did in the 70s and 80s. So, you know, there is a lot. Yeah, well, I mean, of course they can. But the only thing I will say, there are, you know, obviously 8 fantastic teams left in this competition.
Yeah.
And Manchester United is still, you know, coming back after the ban and so forth, still relatively. It's a new thing still. I mean, these teams have been doing it year in, year out, and it would be very difficult.
One or two good teams left in your competition as well, and we'll have a word about that 1-0 defeat in Madrid in a moment. Let's just have a look at the incident where you were booked, and perhaps you tell us what the conversation was between you and the ref.
Well, in his broken English, he just said to me that he understood my problem. But he also has got a problem that he has to get the game going on and he can't afford to be wasting time.
And what was your view of that?
I thought, you know, these people are under a lot of pressure. And I think the time is coming now where there has to be 2 referees on the pitch. If not, there has to be some type of television help for them.
Well, how bad was it? I mean, what was going on behind your goal?
I mean, to be quite honest, I got 2 batteries thrown at me in the warm-up, which one hit me and one didn't. You don't mind, it invariably happens, especially to goalkeepers. You're closest to the crowd than any other players, you're not moving that much.
Yeah.
That's why I became a goalkeeper in the first place. So it just sort of, it went on and on and on. And on that particular goal kick, a whole barrage of lighters and oranges and whatnot came down. And the only reason I stopped is, the gaffer would tell me, my goal kicks aren't the best at the best of times. So, and there were quite a few lighters, 20 or 30 in that particular area, where I had to run to strike the goalkeeper. Now, if I'd gone over on an ankle or something like that, then...
Yeah, absolutely. Then now, we have read that you're proposing to appeal, but can you do that?
No, you can't. Under UEFA regulations, you can't appeal against any booking. What Aston Villa can do is make a written complaint to UEFA about the crowd's behaviour, in which case Atletico will probably be in a lot of hot water, which after the game I said I don't really want. You know, I would rather they say, let's rescind the booking and, you know, spare Atletico a fine. And because, you know, really, I mean, that's more important to me, and I would have thought it was more important to the club than just to sort of fill the coffers.
You've got to be them at Villa Park and you'll forget all about it, won't you?
Most definitely. Yeah, most definitely.
What about the new regime at Villa now? It's a bit early to say, has it settled in? But Colly Moore and the boys, are they fired up by John Gregory, or are they just fired up anyway?
I think in recent weeks we've had our fair share of criticism, which I think has been justifiable.
Yeah.
Considering that we were one of the dark horses for the title at the start of the season, I think, you know, as footballers, you know, you like all the good things and you like taking the wages, and sometimes it become a little bit too cushy and people don't particularly like being criticised. But it's amazing, since we've had that type of criticism, it seemed to have bonded the dressing room together in a way that it hadn't done in the past. And when the new regime, I mean, John Gregory, it's like he hasn't been away. It's still difficult not to call him Gregs. We're still trying to call him boss.
He's part of the family. Let me just ask Ron, how do you rate this guy as a goalkeeper? You signed him, didn't you?
At the risk of embarrassing him, I think he could possibly be the best in the world. He's got certain things, and he's a worker, and sometimes he's potty sometimes, but all goalkeepers are, and he does silly, stupid things, but potentially he could be the best goalkeeper in the world. He's not far short of it now.
He's not one for understatement, is he, Ron? Anyway, searching our video vaults this week, we think we found a man to rival Barry Fry's linguistic talents. Meet the coach with a way with words.
He didn't call you that.
Yes, he did.
Hey, he was kicking him off the mat. He did not call you. He said it talking to the ground.
He looked right at me and called me a f***. He's on report for him.
I didn't think he called you. I said, I heard him say I did not say him. Not hear him say I did not hear him say that. All right, what's up?
Look, he already ran me.
Oh, okay. What do you want? What? You ain't gonna get
nothing. He already ran me.
I know. What are you gonna do?
I'll get my
f***ing. No, go ahead. You didn't call
What?
You didn't call him a
What?
You didn't call him a
Right.
Okay, I know that. I know you didn't call him a He called you a Right. He did not call you a No, he didn't. I'm standing right alongside of him now. If he said it, hey, I heard him say he called you a
That's good enough, period.
Okay, but don't, he didn't say that. He did not say that. Fine, he called you a agree with you, but he did not say you're a
And so it went on. What they were arguing about is whether he called the umpire a nuisance or a flipping nuisance. Subtle difference.
See you next week.
Oh, I'm sorry to tell you.